This was another week in which a lot of things happened. We have seen a symbol of Western civilization burn, many surprises in the global markets, a couple of controversial candidates from UKIP, the rise of a rather curious and likely unconstitutional voting compact, and of course the Mueller report. I simply couldn't decide between these many interesting news items, and with so many ingredients to chew and digest, ladies and gentlemen, it's time again to slow roast these roasted opinions. Let's start with Notre Dame de Paris, the great lady at the heart of France's capital and France itself. This 850-year-old cathedral housed numerous great works of art and unique religious relics, as well as standing as a testament to Gothic architecture and the durability of medieval construction. Then, this happened. I admit freely that my heart broke when I saw the footage, and I'm not a Catholic. Notre Dame de Paris is a global icon. It's listed by UNESCO as a World Heritage Site. It's steeped in centuries of history, and I'm a historian. I thought that the great lady was gone, about to be consumed by the flames of an entire forest of oak rafters burning. I thought that the vaults would collapse, and then the walls as they lost their internal support. I was overjoyed when the doors opened to reveal this. The crucifix, placed close to where the spire collapsed, was untouched. The wooden pulpit was intact. Even the candles, lit by Catholic faithful as they offered prayers before the fire broke out hours earlier, were still burning. The vaults, except where the blow of the falling spire overburdened them, held. Even the beehives above the sacristy survived. The Paris Fire Brigade moved quickly to secure every bit of the treasure trove of history which they could find, and amazingly, over 80% of it has been recovered already. The copper rooster, placed at the peak of the spire, survived both fire and an over 300-foot fall during the collapse, intact. The relics of Saint-Denis and Saint-Geneviève within it may very well be intact. More amazing still, though, is the people of Paris and of France. The Paris Fire Brigade responded quickly and decisively, preventing the spread of the fire to other buildings in the densely constructed district. They managed the fire to prevent the destruction of the rose windows. They contained it so that the bells of Notre Dame were saved and will someday ring again. The people of Paris, many of them non-practicing Catholics, lined the banks of the Seine and wept. They prayed for the safety of the fire brigade and for the containment of the fire. And even though only 5% of all Catholics in France attend Mass on Sundays, they sang hymns. The fire began to renew their faith even as it reduced their cathedral. Emmanuel Macron pledged to rebuild the cathedral and announced a contest to attract reconstruction proposals. Leaders from all over the world expressed condolences and offered assistance to France. Teams began to move even before the fire was out, gathering in Paris to preserve the artifacts and assess the damage. Pledges of hundreds of millions of euros flooded in, especially from billionaire French families. Overall, the heartbreak of the fire was replaced by the inspiration of people rallying together in support of preserving and restoring Notre Dame, except, of course, on social media. If people are going to lose their minds entirely in a given situation, then they will do so on Twitter, right? A large number of them started blaming anyone and everyone for starting the blaze before it was even put out, never mind investigating the cause of the fire, not when one can jump to conclusions which support one's personal biases and narrative. With all of the people who experienced very raw emotions about the fire and the massive damage to the most visited cultural icon in Paris, there were naturally those who were inspired by the fire to post incandescent hot takes about how they were glad that Notre Dame was destroyed as a symbol of white supremacy, religious hypocrisy, colonialism, wage inequality, cultural imperialism, or whatever unrelated social issue they might consider important. Because we need to acknowledge the cathedral fire as just another aspect of the dumpster fire which we call wokeness, right? No. Just no. Of course, since YouTube is determined to implement enough algorithms to choke a mule, live streams of the conflagration were tagged with 9/11 details by the platform. As if we didn't have enough fuel for the conspiracy theories, right? Maybe algorithms are like prescription medicines. Less is more if one wishes to avoid nasty interactions and detrimental side effects. I'm no software engineer, nor am I a computer scientist, but I do remember what happened when Microsoft decided to test an AI named Tay on Twitter. It took very little time for that complex algorithm to collapse, remember? Just one day, and it became a racist, sexist failure. We still got a long way to go before we create a sustainable AI, folks. And until we do, these algorithms simply are not going to work properly. While social media was burning down from all of the hot takes and inevitable backlash against them, we quietly experienced a very curious set of mixed economic news on the markets. It's earnings season again, and that means companies are publishing their quarterly reports and guidance. With a major downturn in economic growth at the end of the fourth quarter of 2018, expectations were negative for the end of the first quarter of 2019. Economists predict doom and gloom, and then nearly 80% of all companies reported solid performances. Of course, with Brexit cycling from approaching threat to imminent doom and back a couple of times, and the rather nasty trade disputes between the United States and its major economic partners, those reported performance figures were not as good as could be expected, but they weren't that bad. There was some bad news out of Europe regarding employment and production levels, but China has shown positive gains in most of their leading economic indicators and make good on their pledges to increase purchases of specific commodities from the United States, especially agricultural commodities, as the intense ongoing negotiations between the two countries continue. Even the bond markets began to edge slowly towards better, more sustainable ground, and labor market figures in the United States bounced back from a dip in the remarkable growth since 2016 to once again indicate that wages are growing, unemployment is refreshingly low, and labor force participation is still increasing in a jobs market which remains very tight, especially in the manufacturing jobs which were reported to be gone forever a few years ago, and in construction, which despite some fairly negative indicators in the housing market, appears to be remarkably short of hands to do the work. So why, then, with so much positive news, are the major U.S. stock indices showing indecision and slow overall growth? Because of the healthcare sector, of course. Several major companies listed on those indices, including names like United Health and Pfizer, are part of the healthcare sector. And as the U.S. inches forward through primary election season, there is a great deal of talk about Medicare for All, one of the tenets of the Green New Deal. The entire field of Democratic Party hopefuls are talking about this proposal, and that is having a profound impact on investment levels in companies which sell health insurance and pharmaceuticals. Even as these companies reported good performances and solid beats of the estimates which economists agreed for the first quarter, uncertainty about what will happen to those companies if Medicare for All becomes a reality in the future has investors paring their exposures. Instead of increasing investment levels, these companies are losing significant amounts of market capitalization, and that is pulling the rest of the market down. A more conspiratorially minded individual might suggest that this is a somewhat effective way to slow down the economy in time for primary season, so that the eventual Democrat nominee doesn't have to run against an incumbent president who has fostered a massive recovery and increased the GDP, employment figures, and market index values to record levels, incidentally indicating that he knows how to stimulate a lagging economy out of a slow, jobless, income disparity-ridden recovery into a strong, generalized, job and opportunity-generating economic surge. I'm trying to resist that urge, folks. Still, despite all of the uncertainty in the global economy and the trade tensions which have severely dampened sentiment, we are still seeing record levels of investment, the lowest levels on unemployment in half a century, rising wages and greater opportunities as companies start to compete for labor, and a continuing series of surprise growth in manufacturing jobs. I just wish that the EU would negotiate in good faith. They haven't done so during Brexit, and now they refuse to do so with the US. Given that the U.S. produces so many agricultural commodities and in such quantities, one would think that her trade partners in more densely populated countries would be interested in agricultural imports from the U.S. Yet the EU refuses to discuss agriculture in their trade negotiations with the U.S. By doing so, they think that they gain the upper hand in these negotiations, just as China believed that slashing imports of U.S. agricultural commodities would force the U.S. negotiators to back down in their insistence that China open her markets and respect intellectual property rights. That's made the last year a rough one for farmers, including a lot of people I know from where I grew up in the upper Midwest. Just like with Brexit, the EU thinks that their trade partners need them more than they need their trade partners. Based on the economic stagnation in Europe right now, I am forced to repeat myself. No. Just no. The EU is going to negotiate themselves into more economic contraction while the United States, China, and other countries open themselves to more equitable trade and explosive economic growth. I wonder if the Executive Council will realize that they have to find a better, more sustainable approach than economic imperialism to trade negotiations. I wouldn't be holding my breath, to be honest. Thanks to their tactics, however, the UK has to participate in European parliamentary elections in order to gain enough time to sort themselves. The unmitigated series of fumbles which the UK government has made during Brexit has led to a resurgence of the UK Independence Party, and they have posted an interesting slate of candidates for the EU parliamentary elections. Carl Benjamin and Mark Meacham have been named by UKIP as candidates for MEP. That's right. Sargon of Akkad and Count Dankula are running for office, and the prices of salt are crashing from oversupply. One might think that God Emperor Trump had handpicked these men as his guys in the EU for all of the screeching involved. Now, I'm not eligible to vote in these elections, and I'm not going to either endorse or oppose those two as they seek office. I will, however, point out that attacks on character are the refuge of those who are afraid to debate policy in so many instances. Dankula and Sargon have demonstrated their knowledge and passion for issues raised by the UK's continued membership in the EU. Their opponents should be addressing that, not opening the debate by giving these two gentlemen a perfect opportunity to point out the rampant anti-Semitism and suppression of free speech levied by their opponents. One has to debate issues if one wants to demonstrate the flaws in the opposition's positions. Degenerating the debate into mudslinging immediately is how people get elected to Parliament who cannot figure out how to open the door and go through when their constituents tell them that they need to leave the room. Not that U.S. elections are as pure as driven snow, mind you. Americans do have their own problems in elections, and one matter of debate which keeps popping up is the Electoral College. It was originally designed to protect the rights of states with small populations, mostly located in New England, from Virginia and Pennsylvania, which together represented over 30% of the total population of America in 1790 America. The founders realized that each state had a distinctive culture based on what was important to people who lived in that state. Remember that Alexander Hamilton and Thomas Jefferson debated this very point, and the Electoral College was meant to foster better elections by preserving the states from the tyranny of the majority, sheltering them from the effects of election fraud, and facilitating the conduct of the election by requiring that delegates travel to cast their ballots based upon the results of the election in their states, rather than compelling the transportation of the ballots if any dispute between the states arose due to the results of the elections. Now, in 2016, we saw an artifact of the Electoral College happen, the election of someone who failed to win the popular vote. That did not sit well with those who knew, absolutely knew, that Hillary Rodham Clinton was going to be the president. The backlash from this has continued ever since, and the latest response is the popular vote interstate compact. So far, 14 states and the District of Columbia have signed into law a compact which requires that their votes be cast for the winner of the national popular vote, regardless as to the results in their own state. That's 189 delegates in total, leaving the winner of the national popular vote 81 votes short of winning the Electoral College by default. There are 13 other states with legislation pending as well, although only Oregon and Nevada have indicated a good chance of successful passage so far. That would bring the total to 202 electoral votes in the bloc. Now, one can see the flaws in the Electoral College system. Personally, I believe that only Maine and Nebraska are managing their delegates properly because they assign the elector for each representative district to the winner of that district and the two electors for the senators to the overall state winner. That will break up the winner-take-all system and force candidates to campaign in more districts. In theory, that's to be desired because it suggests that the candidates will have to listen to more voters in more individual places. The elected officials in these states believe that they are constitutionally able to conclude such a compact if it does not infringe upon federal authority. My response to them is that the Electoral College is constitutionally mandated, and that this compact is a prima facie attempt to eliminate the Electoral College without amending the Constitution. I'm not alone in that opinion, and that creates a constitutional challenge which the Supreme Court can decide. Since this also creates a nullification argument, I would bet that it won't survive judicial review, but the elected officials of these states are still pushing it through despite the untenable constitutional ground upon which they base their arguments, if for no other reason than they cannot count. 5 of the 9 justices on the court are Republican appointees, and this is a Democrat-led proposal. So far, every single jurisdiction which has adopted this compact cast their votes for Hillary Clinton in 2016. They may represent 189 votes, but if the compact had existed in 2016 as constituted now, it would not have changed the results of the election by a single electoral vote. Not one. And speaking of elected officials who cannot understand simple concepts, the Mueller report has been submitted to Congress. Now, Attorney General Barr redacted the report before handing it over, as is his duty. To his credit, he didn't redact the 200 pages of musings about the nature of obstruction which Mueller attached to the report. He simply redacted what he's required by law to redact to maintain privacy and conceal methods, materials, and sources. He handed the redacted 400-page, $30 million report to the Judiciary Committees and then released it. From what I've read, his 4-page summary was pretty accurate, no evidence of collusion and only dubious indications of obstruction. The investigation produced a very, very expensive nothing burger. Just in time for primary season, too. Funny how timing works. Naturally, if social media cannot resist the irony of engaging in flame wars and hot takes over a massive fire at Notre Dame, then they cannot resist launching into a firestorm over Mueller, can they? The media reacted with plenty of emotion, too, gleeful giggles from the right and pained screeching from the rest. The pundits and talking heads decided what the report means before it was published, and then searched its many pages for fertilizer for their latest crop of biased reporting. Conservative pundits reported on Volume 1, the actual report of the investigation, and progressive pundits focused on Volume 2, the philosophical essay about the nature of obstruction from a legal perspective. And Twitter melted down like the lead roof of Notre Dame. Is all of society regressing into childhood now? For the love of all that is holy, why? Has it become impossible for people to sit down with each other and politely discuss issues over beer and pizza without a pressing need to vet the group for homogeneous thought only? One would think that a diversity of perspectives and proposed solutions would be a valuable asset to forming consensus, but that seems to work only when the diverse group can agree upon what the issue of discussion is. A rare occurrence these days, it seems. No, we'd rather sit and mock those who line the banks of society, weeping while the symbols of centuries of societal evolution burn. We'd rather baselessly accuse those symbols of being representative of the worst aspects of our collective history and culture. We'd rather see the institutions crumble in flames than attempt to put out the fires and rebuild, or just rejoice in their destruction. Just so long as we can self-aggrandize, that is. It's literally true in regard to Notre Dame, and figuratively true everywhere else.